हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर दीपक गर्ग। आई एम एन ऑर्थोपेडिक सर्जन एंड टुडे वी विल डिस्कस स्टेप बाय स्टेप अप्रोच टू सिंगल बंडल एंटीरियर क्रूसिएट लिगामेंट रिकंस्ट्रक्शन यूजिंग हैमस्ट्रिंग्स ऑटोग्राफ्ट एंड वी विल डिस्कस द बायोमैकेनिक्स ऑफ ईच स्टेप। सो लेट्स फर्स्ट स्टार्ट विद द एनाटॉमी ऑफ एंटीरियर क्रूसिएट लिगामेंट। सो द एंटीरियर क्रूसिएट लिगामेंट इज अप्रोक्सीमेटली 31 टू 35 mm इन लेंथ and the width is approximately 10 mm and it is approximately 3 mm thick. It has two bundles, anteromedial and posterolateral. So if we look at the insertion of the ACL on the femur, then it is inserted on the medial surface of lateral femoral condyle and it is well posterior to longitudinal axis of femoral shaft. If we look this into detail, let's imagine this is the medial surface of lateral femoral condyle that we see through arthroscopy. Then we can see that both the anteromedial and the posterolateral bundles are going and inserting on to the posterior surface of the medial femoral part of the lateral femoral condyle, and this is making a linear line, a linear horizontal line. This insertion is making a linear horizontal line, and there is a elevation on the bone at this line, and this linear elevation is called as resident's ridge. Let's look this into detail. We are looking at this area. Again, this is an area, medial surface of the lateral femoral condyle, and if we divide this area into four parts, four equal parts, and these parts are the posterior superior, anterior superior, posterior inferior, anterior superior, then we can see that the resident's ridge is lying in the posterior superior area. So this is lying on the posterior and superior half of the lateral wall of the intercondylar notch, and this is roughly 7 to 10 mm anterior to the posteromedial articular cartilage margin of lateral femoral condyle. So this is very crucial to identify the resident's ridge, because this will help us later on making a femoral tunnel. Let's similarly look at the tibial insertion of anterior cruciate ligament. So this is anterolateral to the anterior tibial spine, so, and it is medial to the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. So this is about the tibial insertion. Let's now look at the position of the patient. When we perform the ACL reconstruction, we keep the patient in supine position. We will use a support for the foot so that we can keep the knee in 90 degree of flexion, and we will use the side support. And then we will mark the surgical landmarks. We will mark the patellar tendon. We will mark the medial joint line. We will mark the lateral joint line. We will mark the anterolateral portal. We will mark the anteromedial portal, accessory medial portal. We will mark skin marking for graft harvesting. And it is approximately 3 finger breadths below the joint line and approximately 1 to 2 centimeter medial to the tibial shin. Sometimes we can feel for the tendons, and if we can feel the tendon, then we can mark accordingly. So once we mark it, we will take the skin incision, we will dissect the fat, and we will expose the sartorial fascia. Then we will go little on the lateral side, we will cut the fascia and we will elevate the fascia, will reflect the layers of the fascia, and then we will be able to identify the tendons, gracilis tendon and semi tendinosus tendon. So once we identify the tendons, we will tie the tendons with the ethibond suture, and then we will release all the bands that are attached with the tendon, and we will try to feel for the free movement of the tendon. Once we are able to feel for the free movement, then we will harvest the graft with tendon stripper. This is how we take the graft. Now once we take the graft, we prepare the graft, we remove all the soft tissue from the graft. We can use a metal scale to remove the soft tissue. So then we will first measure the length of the graft. So to measure the length of the graft, let's just understand this in detail. So let's divide the graft length into parts. So the part one, so the part one is the length of the graft from the end and to the part one. So this indicate the amount of the graft that will go into the femoral tunnel, so that will go inside the femoral tunnel. So this is approximately 2 mm. So if we roughly discuss the length of the lateral femoral condyle from the entry point to the exit is approximately 3 to 4 cm. So we will have to decide the part of the graft that will go inside the femoral tunnel. Let's say roughly we usually take 2 cm graft will go into the femoral tunnel, and so if the femoral tunnel length is 4 cm, we choose 2 cm of the graft will go into the femoral tunnel. That is a part one. Now part two is the intra-articular length of anterior cruciate ligament. So as we have already seen, the intra-articular length of the ACL is roughly 31 to 35 mm, so roughly we take 3 cm. So the part two is approximately 3 cm, and it is the intra-articular length of the anterior cruciate ligament. Then it is part 3. So the part 3 will go into the tibial tunnel, and where we will fix it with the interference screw. So it is again approximately 2 cm. So now if we mark part 1, part 2 and part 3, so we will mark the part 1 at 2 cm, part 2 at 2 + 3 = 5 cm, and part 4 2 + 3 + 2 approximately 7 cm. So the total length, that minimum length that we need is approximately 7 cm. So we aim for a length which is more than 7 cm. So we aim for approximately more than 8 to 9 cm or 10 cm, so that we will not have trouble during the procedure and the length will not fall short. So these are the marks. The first mark is the length approximately 2 cm, second is at approximately 5, and third is approximately at 7 cm. So then we will mark measure the thickness of the graft. So we already know the in the intra-articular normal, the thickness of the ACL is approximately 10 × 3 mm, so 10 mm is a normal thickness. So we aim for a thickness of around 10 mm, so that the strength of the graft will be equal to the normal anterior cruciate ligament. And the other reason to measure the thickness is to choose the rimmer for tibial and femoral rimmer. So in the tibial rimmer we use 0.5 to 1 mm larger, and in the femoral tunnel we use approximately the same size of the rimmer for the graft. So now once we take the graft, then we will just mark the periosteal window through the tibial tunnel. Here we feel with the finger for the posterior border of the tibia, and we feel for the tibial sin, and roughly the center point of the two we will release the periosteum. We expose the bone and we make the periosteal window, and then we will mark this window so that later on we will be able to identify it easily. So after this, taking the graft, then we will mark the anterolateral portal. We will use the scope introducer with the, our direction will be towards the notch, and once we do the from the anterolateral portal, we will introduce the scope and we will do the diagnostic arthroscopy. We will see for the ACL tear. And then we will, after the diagnostic arthroscopy, we will do the anteromedial portal. For the anteromedial portal, we will first use a spinal needle to create an anteromedial tunnel. Our direction will be again towards the femoral entry point, means towards the notch only. And we will use a spinal needle first just to prevent injury to the meniscus. And then after confirming the direction, we will use a 11 number plate in the same direction to create the anteromedial portal. So then we will use a dilator to dilate the anteromedial hole. And after this, we have already identified the remnants of the tibial and the femoral footprints. And then we will clear the notch area for femoral entry and clear the tibial footprints for preparation of the entry point of the tibia. So let's understand a little bit about the biomechanics and tibial entry guide. So this the picture we are able to see, this is a tibial entry guide that we can see here. And let's understand the tibial entry guide. With the tip here, we can see this tip we will put at the tibial ACL insertion inside the knee joint. And for the best function, we place the graft at the posterior portion, that is the posterolateral bundle. This is called near posterolateral bundle position. We will look this position in detail. And this angle, which this is a normal angle of the jig, present in the jig, and this angle we take approximately 45 to 55 degrees. We usually take a 45 degree of angle. And then jig we place approximately 30 degree medial to the mid sagittal axis. So from the sin we take we imagine a plane, and then we will go approximately 30 degree medial to the mid sagittal, that this plane, and there where we will keep the jig, and this is approximately will come 4 cm below the joint line where the entry point of the jig will be there from the tibia to inside the joint. So if we to look at the exit point or where we will put the tip of that jig inside the joint, so it is approximately 3 mm posterior to the center of the ACL footprint. So we can see here, this is the ACL footprint, and we go 3 mm posterior to the center of ACL footprint, and then we identify the posterior border of the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus, and then we will stay posterior to the lateral meniscus anterior horn, and then 7 mm anterior to the anterior border of the posterior cruciate ligament. And when we measure, look at this, our knee should be in 90 degree of flexion, and this is the entry exit point, or the entry point for the exit point for the rimmer. So again, just to summarize it, it is approximately 7 mm anterior to PCL, and we will stay posterior on the posterior aspect of the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. These are the landmarks that we usually use during this arthroscopy. Now we take the tibial entry, we put the jig, and we already have seen the angles, and then we take the tibial entry, and after the entry we do the drilling, and we put the drill, keep the drill bit inside, and then we remove the jig, and at this point we do the rimming. So we have already seen that the size of the rimmer that we choose is half or 1 mm larger than the graft size that we have harvested. So we do the rimming, and we reach the intra-articular. We with the same rimmer we rim the whole canal of the tibia. So then after we have rimmed, we have made a entry point inside the joint, then we will clean the soft tissue around the tunnel inside the joint for a clear vision. And after we have created the tibial tunnel, then we will start for the femoral tunnel. And for the femoral tunnel, we can see here from the picture, this is a flexible guide pin for femoral tunnel from anteromedial portal. So where should we keep the tip? So we already know that we have already seen the from the anatomy part that the insertion of the anterior cruciate ligament on the femoral. So we need two axes to see for the exact point where we should keep this tip. So from the front view, we can see we use a over the top position, and it is approximately 3 o'clock or 9 o'clock position. 3 o'clock on the left side, 9 o'clock on the right side, and we keep the knee in 90 degree flexion during planning the entry point. So from here we know that this is a 9 o'clock position, and this is one plane that we have got. This is the plane where showing the 9 o'clock position. Now we have to decide the whether we have to be anterior or posterior. Now we already know that the insertion is on the posterior superior surface. Now we will go on the posterior superior surface, then we will use the radio frequency device, and we will clean the posterior superior surface, and then we will try to identify the residence ridge. Then we will mark the point of the residence ridge, and we will try to stay posterior to the residence ridge, and this will be the point. So it will give us a precise or accurate entry point for the femoral tunnel. Once we identify this point, we mark this point, and this is a picture showing how we take the femoral tunnel. So now we keep this tip of the femoral guide on the entry point. We are viewing on the with the scope, like we are watching this with the scope, and we have kept our entry guide here, and then we will just take entry point with the drill, and we take the entry, and we exit from the other side and on the anterior side. So once we come out, so we will have to first make sure that now this will we will have to keep our assistant to hold the pin so that the pin will not slip out. Now we will have to rim, so we will first use a small rimmer, approximately 4.5 mm rimmer we will use, and then we will remove both the cortices with the 4.5 mm rimmer. We will rim the near cortex and the far cortex, and this is the size of the remor that will allow the entry of the endobutton loop to go to pass through this tunnel and outside the femoral canal, so that it will be able to flip easily. And once we have done this, now we have to decide the amount of the graft that will go inside the femoral tunnel. So if we have planned two centimeter of the graft will go inside the femoral tunnel, then we will rim approximately 2 centimeter size, and we will rim with a larger rimmer, approximately 9 mm or 10 mm. It is equal to the size of the graft that we have taken. So we will rim approximately 2 centimeter, so that because we have planned 2 centimeter of the graft that will go inside the femoral tunnel. So we will rim. So now there is a drill bit inside, and we have rimmed with the smaller rimmer the near and the far cortex, and we have rimmed approximately 20 mm for the graft. So now after we have created the canal, then we will use the sever to clear the debris around the entry point or the femoral tunnel, so that we will be able to view it clearly. Now we will put the Ethibond suture inside in the guide pin, so that now we can then we will pull the guide pin to get the suture out through the femoral tunnel. Now on the one side the femoral tunnel, we will keep the assistant to hold this Ethibond suture, and on the other side we will hold the suture with our finger. Now we will introduce the and grab the suture through the tibial tunnel. Now we will go through the tibial tunnel to get this Ethibond suture out through the tibial tunnel. Now at this point the tibial the Ethibond suture is passing from the tibial tunnel to the intra-articular, and then going through the femoral tunnel to the outside. So at this point we will have to pass the graft. Now just for the knowledge, the femoral condyle length is approximately between 30 to 40 mm. It's always true, it is 30 to 40 mm. Now we have planned 20 mm of the length of the graft that we will usually take for the femoral tunnel. Now the mark on the loop and the graft, now this is the mark, first mark, this is the distance of the width of the femoral condyle from the end of the endobutton. So approximately it is 30 to 40 mm. So at this point when we rim, we measure the length of the tunnel with a small rimmer. So we measure the condyle length, so we will mark the condyle length from the end of the endobutton loop. This is the mark 1, and then mark 2 is the amount of the graft that will go inside the femoral tunnel, which is approximately 20 mm in our case. So if we will again look at these two marks, the mark 1 indicate the length of the condyle, and the mark 2 indicate the amount of the graft that will go inside the femoral tunnel. So now we will pass the graft. Ethibond suture is inside from the tibia to the intra-articular to the femoral tunnel. We will pass the graft with the Ethibond suture inside, and then we will pull the Ethibond suture so that the graft will start passing. And when the mark 1 will reach, it will indicate the amount of the loop has passed equal to the femoral condyle. So now the endobutton can flip. So we can feel the button flip at this point, or we can try to pull out the graft if it has already flipped, just to indicate that the button has already flipped. It will not come out. Now we will pull the graft, and when the mark 2 will come, it will indicate that the 20 mm of the graft or the desired amount of the graft has already passed through the tunnel. So this is the amount that we want to pull. So now we can tighten the endobutton loop at this point. Now after this point we will apply the manual tension, and we do the cycling movement to keep knee into flexion and extension. This allows some soft tissue elongation or creep. Now after this point we have already passed the graft. Now we will fix the tibial side into full extension, and with the tension applied to the graft, we will always keep the tension so that the graft creep will not be there, graft elongation will not be there. And then we will apply the we will keep the knee in extension and we will apply the interference screw, keeping the graft in tension. Now assistant can apply downward force on tibia during the interference screw application. This will reduce the tibia. So now we can fix the suture anchor on the tibia to supplement the fixation. This is a supplementary process, we can do this or not. So this was about the anterior cruciate ligament reconstruction. So thank you guys, thank you very much.